Aquinas, he combines the theology of Augustine with the philosophy of Aristotle. And one of the things that he does is he writes a commentary on Aristotle's Politics, and he further develops this idea of political economy. And his work leads to what's called the Salamanca School of Economics. And here's a picture of those guys in their little school there. And starting in the 14th century, you had these guys, and they're studying Aquinas's commentaries on the Politics. And here's one of the things that they understood, that God ordered everything and that economics is an ethical discipline. And they believe that government should do certain things and refrain from doing certain things if the common good was going to be served. Like being careful with how much money they spent, you know, that they didn't debase their currency, that they that basically they allowed for free trade. A lot of these ideas. You know, basically, it started with the Dominicans, and they argued for the importance of free markets and against government intervention in the economy. Let me tell you, every time the government intervenes in the economy, we pay for it. There is a set of unintended consequences that come down the line. So the Dominicans were eventually joined by the Franciscans and then eventually the Jesuits, and they wrote tons of material. And this guy, Francis Hutcheson, he was a professor of moral philosophy, and he was a Presbyterian minister, by the way. And he developed the concept of the division of labor. He says that basically, rather than everybody trying to be the jack of all trades, they should specialize in something. And if they specialize, they will make better products, they'll produce better services. And in exchange, what happens is everybody is better off. Well, he has a student. He has a number of students. The most important of these is this guy, Adam Smith. Now, what you will hear a lot of people say is that this guy is the father of economics and how this guy thought it all up. Well, let me tell you, he was a smart guy. But you know what? He didn't think it all up. He took all the work of the Salamanca School. He repackaged it. In fact, cut some of it out. Some of the wrong stuff he just cut out. And unfortunately, well, the Wealth of Nations, for the most part, is right. But where it's wrong, it's seriously wrong. Like, the theory of value that he created basically sent economics down one wrong road for the next 80 years. But the bottom line is this. He believed that a free market economy with a laissez-faire government was the system that best promoted virtue and minimized vice. And as we said before, in a laissez-faire, in a free market economy with a laissez-faire government, what happens is you have motivation to do your best. You have motivation to sell more, to be creative, to be wise with your resources, to be virtuous, because if you are, you're more likely to succeed. If, on the other hand, you're foolish with your resources, then you're going to wind up in poverty. He believed that the place of government was to ensure a level playing field. Not much more than that. Government should allow free trade, and government should spend money on three things: public works. What do we mean by public works? Roads, bridges, national defense, and a judicial legal system. That's all government should spend money on. Now, today, what do people say we should spend money on? It's incredible! And you know, I gotta tell you, I think that a lot of these people don't have an ability to add or subtract. They do have a good ability to divide me from my money, one group of people against another group of people. They have a real good ability to divide, not a real good ability to add or subtract. In fact, a lot of those people, like these guys, let's take a look at some of their wonderful ideas. Theirs is an atheistic system based on metaphysical materialism. They desire to get rid of private ownership and give the state the means of production. Okay, any of you ever had any dealings with the DMV? They're a model for efficiency, huh? They're a bad model. Can you imagine giving them all the means of production? What would you get? Not anything good, I can tell you that much. So they desire to get rid of private ownership. The socialism is a halfway house in their goal of a worldwide system. They endorsed a worldwide revolution to install their system. And so here are some of the extremes of socialism, okay? Fascism is national socialism. It's only one step away from communism, and some of the wonderful countries that have tried it are Nazi Germany, Italy, Japan, and, you know, a lot of the Islamic nations right now are, you know, they're playing with a kind of Nazism as well. Communism is worldwide socialism. And these two groups of political thought don't really get along, and here's why. See, fascists are always big about their own country. But the problem with fascism is, let's say we had a fascist government installed today, and they wanted to take all of our personal property. What would happen? Well, most of us would leave. A lot of people would just leave and take our capital with us. So how do you get around this problem? That's what communism is for. If you make every place socialist, where do you run to? There's no place to run to. So, here are some other guys from the Austrian School of Economics, Ludwig von Mises, Friedrich von Hayek, and these guys hate socialism in all of its forms. So, school started by Karl Menger. It's a free market approach to economics. And these guys were very much in line with the thinking of the Salamanca school, even more so than Adam Smith. And they believe that morality and economics are intertwined, that you really can't separate them. And so, Von Mises and Hayek, they both won Nobel Prizes in economics. And here's another significant figure, John Neville Keynes. He was a professor of political economy at Cambridge University. And basically, you know, political economy was taught in the School of Moral Philosophy. But here's what John Neville Keynes does. He divides economics into three approaches: positive, normative, and practical economics. Now, if you go to school today and you get a master's degree or a bachelor's degree in economics, what you will study is positive economics. What you're going to see is, what you're only going to focus on is what happens if you make this change. You're going to look at the numbers, you're going to do some econometric analysis, you're going to try to find out what happens if you do this or what happens if that thing happens. And they try to view it as a science. And they try to look at the whole thing completely apart from its moral dimension.